Well, the Inquisition, as a bureaucratic organization, had a chief executive officer known as a Grand Inquisitor. The Grand Inquisitor oversaw the apparatus of the Inquisition, and in each national territory where the Inquisition was operating, there might be a different Grand Inquisitor. The name that is most famous is the one you've given, which is Torquemada. Cardinal Richelieu was not an inquisitor, but Torquemada was the Grand Inquisitor of Spain. He, in a sense, invented the Spanish Inquisition, lobbied for it, and ran it. And that was the man at the top of the chain of command. But the work of the Inquisition was done by friars of the Dominican and Franciscan order. The history tells us that even at the time the Inquisition was in operation, the Dominicans came to be known as Dominicanes. It's a pun on the word Dominican, and it means the hounds of the Lord, suggesting that these friars were set upon the enemies of the church, as you might set the dogs on an animal.
And so does Torquemada, does he deserve the reputation that he has?
We know most, of all the Grand Inquisitors, we know the most about Torquemada. He supervised what was arguably the most ambitious and effective phase of the Inquisition, and he certainly is well deserving of his reputation as a bloodthirsty persecutor. He prevailed upon Ferdinand and Isabella, the King and Queen of Spain, who we know as the monarchs who sent Columbus on his voyages of discovery, which resulted in the discovery of the New World and the creation of the American democracy in the fullness of time. I mean, Ferdinand and Isabella are famous for that, but Torquemada, who was the confessor to Queen Isabella, whispered in her ear that Spain needed its own Inquisition. The Inquisition was not active in Spain until Torquemada came up with the idea of getting a franchise from the Pope in Rome to set up and run an Inquisition in Spain. He managed to persuade the King and Queen of Spain to do so. They persuaded the Pope to grant them a franchise, and thus the Spanish Inquisition came into existence.
And up until that point, Spain had been relatively peaceful, kind of pluralistic society?
For long periods of history, Jews, Muslims, and Catholics coexisted in peace, harmony, and prosperity with each other in Spain. Now, during some of that period, political sovereignty was held by Muslim overlords. It was actually a Muslim kingdom. Ferdinand and Isabella famously evicted the Muslim kings and sovereigns from Spain and made it a Catholic country, and they decided that this peaceful coexistence among Jews, Christians, and Muslims could no longer be tolerated. And so in 1492, the same year that Columbus sailed for America, they issued an edict which said that anyone in Spain who was not Catholic had to either convert or leave. This was applied first to the Jews and later to the Muslims. And the chief work of the Inquisition was to make sure that all converted Catholics were in fact practicing Catholicism and not secretly practicing Judaism or Islam. And that's why a great many victims of the Spanish Inquisition were converted Jews and converted Muslims.
And interesting, so even though they could publicly convert, that still wouldn't satisfy the Inquisition. Does the Spanish Inquisition deserve its reputation as being the most vicious of the various waves of the Inquisition within the Church?
It does, and for a very specific reason, and I want to come into tight focus on this. Prior to the Spanish Inquisition, heresy was purely and simply a thought crime, as George Orwell describes it in 1984. It was the crime of holding the wrong thought in your head. And you could acquit yourself of this crime. This is so important. by renouncing the false belief. You didn't have to die at the stake if you were accused of heresy, so long as you confessed that you had held this impermissible thought and you renounced it and repudiated it and embraced the Catholic dogma. If you did all of those things, you would not be put to death. You might still be punished, but you wouldn't be executed. The Spanish Inquisition had a terrible innovation which suggested that if you had Jewish ancestry or Islamic ancestry, you could not truly be an earnest convert to Catholicism. So it was not the thought in your head that mattered, it was the blood in your veins. And obviously there's nothing you could do about that. Confessing was not enough. And that terrible innovation, turning heresy from a thought crime into a blood crime, was something new and terrible in the history of the Inquisition. And as I argue in my book, it prefigures the crimes of Nazi Germany in a direct and shocking way. The Nazis, too, regarded the wrong kind of blood in your veins as a crime for which death was the only suitable punishment. And that idea can be traced back not to the Inquisition in general, but to the Spanish Inquisition in particular.
The idea of you being killed as a way of saving your life, does that also not tie into this later to the Salem witch trials?
Sure. Well, being killed as a way of saving your soul, let's put
right.
it that way.
Your eternal life.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Your life after death.
Right.
It was the case that if you refused to confess and recant your heresy, you were an unrepentant heretic, you would be put to death. Up until the last moment before the flames extinguished your life, a priest would stand in front of you with a cross at the end of a long pole and hold that cross in front of your face as you were dying, in the hope that you would see the light before you died. Now, by then, of course, it would be too late to save your mortal life. But they earnestly, the inquisitors earnestly believed that if you, you renounced your sin in the last moments before you died, that at least your eternal soul would be saved.
But then, if you did recant, if you did admit that you had been a heretic or you'd been a witch or whatever, then you still didn't necessarily escape the flames.
Well, that's true, and I should pause and say that confession meant something very specific in the eyes of the Inquisition, and here's another example of what I call in my book the long shadow of the Inquisition. It was never enough, not in any phase of the Inquisition, including the Spanish Inquisition, it was never enough to say to the Inquisitors, I confess I was a heretic, I renounce my heresy. You had to show that you were earnest in your confession by naming names. You had to denounce and betray others who shared your heretical belief. Unless you named names, your confession was rejected and considered to be insincere. If you did make an earnest confession, what they deemed to be an earnest confession, you confess your own guilt of the thought crime of heresy, you named others, then in theory, your life would be spared. But there's a catch-22 at work there, too. If you confessed under torture, and then you later renounced your confession because it had been given under torture, you say, I didn't really mean any of those things, I only said them because you were torturing me, then you were once again an unrepentant heretic. And at that point, you could be sent to the stake.
And the long shadow of that, then, too, looms over both the Salem witch trials, and then later, as we saw in the parallel of The Crucible by Arthur Miller, right?
Exactly.
In the communist witch trials as well, so to speak.
Exactly right. In both of those unfortunate...